Hello and welcome to the first of our films for this year's Self-Denial Appeal. My name is Ben Cottrell, and as we live through the various lockdown measures in place across our territory, I'm going to be looking beyond our borders. For this year's Self-Denial Appeal, I'm going to focus on some of the places we've featured in previous appeals and catch up with people we've met along the way to find out how they've been coping during the pandemic. But first, let's look at last year's appeal. Last year, we travelled to the city of Ouagadougou in Burkina Faso. We met Andre and Nana Togo and saw some of the amazing things that they're doing there. We saw a thriving corps full of enthusiastic new soldiers, and we saw how the Salvation Army is supporting people in the local community. You gave generously once again. Thank you so much. Your self-denial money is already being put to good use. And as a little reminder about how self-denial works, here's Ashley Bowles, who presented our films a couple of years ago.
The money you gave through self-denial is used to support the mission of the Salvation Army around the world, including our mission partners. The idea of self-denial was first introduced in London by William Booth in 1886. He said, "Go without something and give what you would have spent to the Salvation Army's work." That was over 130 years ago. Now, nearly every Salvation Army Corps the world over plays its part. So if you are giving in London, Llanelli, Larne or Lockerbie, you are joining with Salvationists in Oslo, Ohio or Ouagadougou, which is the capital city of Burkina Faso. The money is redistributed by international headquarters to the places that need it most. It funds the background things, the not so exciting but essential things, so that Salvation Army staff and volunteers can get on and do what they're good at, like the work in Burkina Faso.
Well, as Ashley has reminded us, some of the self-denial money you raised goes to our mission partners, but quite a lot goes to other mission support work all over the globe. Mission support was crucial in enabling the work in Burkina Faso as the seedling Salvation Army took root and began to flourish. For over a year, I've had the privilege of working for the International Development Team at Territorial Headquarters. It's given me a further insight into the international work of the Salvation Army, and I've been involved in some of the projects which have been funded by self-denial. I live here at William Booth College with my wife Rebecca and our two children. And in a few weeks' time, we'll be moving to a court in East London. But this time last year, we were waiting for visas to go and work in Pakistan. Like so many other people around the world, our plans were disrupted by the global pandemic. Of course, lots of people have faced real hardship, and while it's been frustrating for us, we are well and healthy, so we are grateful for that. As we adjust to this change for us, and as we think about self-denial, I want to find out about how the Salvation Army around the world has adapted. So for the next 5 weeks, we'll be revisiting some of the places we've been to before. I'll be asking people how they're coping and what life is like where they are. I'll be talking to Fozia Columbus in Pakistan. She featured in 2016 when Kerry Coke visited the Salvation Army's territorial headquarters in Lahore. I'll be talking to Melinda Boone from the Philippines. Melinda features in the Salvation Army's Helping Hand Appeal films from last year. She works in anti-human trafficking. I'll be talking to Richard Bradbury. Richard and his wife Heidi have been serving in Bangladesh for the last 2.5 years. They're there with their two children and work at headquarters in Dhaka, the country's capital. But next week, we'll pick up where we left off last year. I'll be talking to Nana Togo, who we saw in Burkina Faso. I'll look forward to seeing you then.